This is Fred Foy. Join us now as we travel back in time and relive some of the magic that was part of the golden age of radio. It's time now for another episode of The Glowing Dial here on Yesterday USA.
Quiet, numbskulls. I'm broadcasting. Use Gritto, radio friends. The soap that gives your hands that dishpan look. How will the old man know you've been working if your hands don't have that dishpan look? Put a box of Gritto in a glass of water. Then listen to it fizz. Dopes. Remember, Gritto, spelled sideways, is Otrigger. And now Gritto's own story of Sandra Sandpile, and here's Mud in Your Eye. Music.
I heard you on the wireless back in 52, lying awake intently tuning in on you. If I was young, it didn't stop you coming through.
Now the hosts of The Glowing Dial, Big John and Steve.
Well, thank you very much, Fred Foy, and hello, everybody. Welcome to another edition of that fantabulous old-time radio program. Pardon the plosive there. The Glowing Dial here on Yesterday USA Radio, going around the world and into your homes. Big John with you for another roughly 55 minutes of old-time radio entertainment. We've got a celebrity interview this time around. We also have another old-time radio show by request. Sadly, Mr. Steve Archiver Bannock, my usual sidekick, cannot be with us this particular program, as our schedules, just a very unique set of circumstances, folks. Our schedules just didn't match up, so he wasn't able to be here this evening. But we will have him back probably the next episode. He'll be back with us, making the wisecracks and getting that good chemistry we have. People say Steve and I have great chemistry on the air, so we'd like to think we do. So, celebrity interview, as I mentioned, is with none other than Leonard Maltin. Yes, Leonard Maltin of Entertainment Tonight and all the TV movie books he's written. A brand new book he just wrote to the Great American Broadcast, and just a wonderful, wonderful book. I suggest you pick it up. It is well worth a read. And we'll be talking with Leonard. But first of all, we must pause for an all-important message from our sponsor.
See, here's how to make breakfast as exciting as a circus and a three-day rodeo rolled into one.
Shredded, rolling for your breakfast. Start the day all shining bright. Gives you lots of cowboy energy with a flavor that's just right. It's delicious and nutritious, bite-sized and ready to eat. Take a sip from Tongo and tell your mom Shredded Ralston, KBB.
For better breakfast, it's Ralston. One, two, three. Shredded Ralston, the ready-to-eat bite-sized cereal. Regular Ralston and Instant Ralston, the delicious hot cereals. Look for these whole-grain cereals in the red and white checkerboard packages. For better breakfasts, it's Ralston. One, two, three.
Well, thank you for that most important commercial announcement there. That's an old-time radio commercial, of course. You know that. We don't plug any real products here on Yesterday USA. Sorry about the plosive again, folks. I'm using a different mic this time. I think I'll go back to the old standby. Sounds a lot better than this thing does. Anyway, let's get right on into that interview with Leonard Maltin. This was done at the Friends of Old-Time Radio Convention, Newark, New Jersey, in October of 1996. Enjoy. We have with us in our Glowing Dial Studios East, Leonard Maltin. Welcome, Leonard.
Thank you.
Who has taken some time out of his busy schedule here at the Friends of Old Time Radio Convention to spend a few moments with us and talk with us. Leonard, I'd like to start with going back a ways. How did you first get started in what you're doing in show business?
Well, I don't know that I'm in show business. I'm on television, but
well, kind of
I guess I'm in show business. I never thought I would be. I mean, as a kid, I got hooked on old movies. That's what really happened, only I didn't know they were old movies.
Right.
Because I was a child of the first TV generation, so I was watching Laurel and Hardy every day, and The Little Rascals, Our Gang, and The Three Stooges, and I was watching Walt Disney's weekly TV show, and cartoons by the carload, and gradually came to understand that they were old, and got intrigued with that, and intrigued with wanting to know more about the history and the people, and went to my local library. I remember the first book I ever took out of the library was the autobiography of Max Sennett, King of Comedy.
All right, yes.
And then John McCabe wrote his book Mr. Laurel and Mr. Hardy, and I had that perpetually out on loan. I forget how long you could keep a book, whether it was 2 weeks or 3 weeks, but I'd read it, live with it, return it, and then check it out again.
Uh-huh, yeah.
So I really got immersed in all of that, and at the time there were 8mm home movies. I'm talking about the Cro-Magnon era before home video.
Blackhawk Films.
Blackhawk Films. You could buy these things on 8mm, and I used to save up my money and do that, and that's what I'd ask for at my birthday and such. And so I just got completely hooked on old movies and on movie history. And I was very lucky, also because I loved to write, and so this enabled me to combine my two interests, writing and an interest in movie history. So I started writing articles and publishing my own little magazine, and then getting published in other fanzines and, you know, magazines for enthusiasts of all of this. And I never really thought about how I'd turn that into a career or how I'd make a living at it, but it just sort of happened, mostly from writing,
right?
And then quite by accident and by chance on television, which the best part of which is that it helped promote my writing more,
right?
Because it made me more familiar to people, and that was wonderful. So, having done this for many years and having written many books about different facets of movie history, animation, and Walt Disney, and comedy teams and Our Gang, all the things that interested me as a kid. I'm sort of a Johnny-come-lately to old-time radio, relatively speaking.
Right.
But I got immersed in that and about 15 years ago, and I said, I've got to write about this because it's just too fascinating to me. And I felt that no one else had written the kind of book I wanted to write. There were wonderful books out there, good reference books, several really nice memoirs, reminiscences, but there wasn't a kind of an overall survey about radio that was a largely anecdotal history.
Okay, there was the reference, like John Dunning's
John Dunning's fabulous book, and Frank Buxton and Bill Owens' book, and of course John has I think will be the definitive reference book coming out next year.
Yeah.
His vastly updated and rewritten.
We interviewed him a couple months back, so.
So that was the book I wanted to write, and I also wanted it as an excuse, really, to get to meet all these people.
Right.
You know, and I was lucky because I started on this 11 years ago, and I never intended it would take that long to finish writing it, but had I not started 11 years ago, I would have missed meeting an awful lot of great people who passed on.
Yeah, I have had many pass on.
And so I feel in a way I got to it in the nick of time.
And the book we're talking about here is called The Great American Broadcast. Published by Dutton, and it's a beautiful hardcover book. I just purchased it here at the convention and had Leonard sign it for me.
And thank you for that.
Yes. I just made Leonard a little richer here. But it is some 300 pages long, and I have hardly had just a chance just to thumb through it right now, but when I get home, I'm going to start reading it. There's all these beautiful pictures here. The first transmitter at WWJ. This is just a treasure of information here.
I really have enjoyed living with this these 11 years because most books and most articles that I write, like any professional writer, you write on a deadline.
Right.
Yeah. And you write on an assignment, and you have to get it done. And this one, the publisher realized long ago that the deadline was a, you know, a fiction. Mm-hmm. it would never happen in the time we intended it to, because it's the same publisher that publishes my other books, my movie guides and
right,
things.
Uh-huh.
So they knew I hadn't skipped town, and they weren't worried, and they were very, very understanding and patient. So when it stretched into a number of years, because other assignments got in the way, it meant I could live with it longer and think about it more and really distill my thoughts and refine my thoughts and my writing,
right.
and get more interviews. I mean, I ended up with about 100 interviews altogether.
Oh, wow.
And what's funny about it, though, is that as many as I did is as many as I didn't do. There's still more people out there and more to be learned and more to be found. I don't pretend for a moment this is a definitive book, about radio, because as I said, I think in the introduction, to say you're writing a book about radio is like saying you're writing a book about the movies. You can't cover it in one book.
Exactly.
There's it's too just too facets. Vast. It's too broad. So I just met a fellow, Gerald Nachman, who's writing another book on radio for a major publisher coming out next year. And he said he was nervous when he heard mine was coming out. And I understand that, because I've been in that position as an author, too.
Uh-huh.
But then he had read mine and realized that he was taking a different tack, a different approach.
Okay.
And I said, well, that's great. You know, because then there'll be another good book on radio, because I think he's I've read some of his things, and he's a good writer.
Mm-hmm.
Well, terrific. You know, the more the merrier.
Right.
Because it's a wonderful subject. It's a very rich subject. There's so much to be explored. So much research to be done, and I think it's exciting that we're coming to a juncture right about now,
right,
where a lot of research is being done and a lot of writing's being done, and more shows are being unearthed.
A lot of restoration is taking
place,
too.
That's
a very important issue with a lot
too.
Of collectors.
You
that,
bet. So I think it's a great time, and of course I'm very happy the book is out now at a time when there seems to be growing awareness beyond just mm-hmm. the circle of the buffs and collectors who've
right,
always been
yeah.
into it.
Well, that's what Yesterday USA is all about. We're trying to preserve the programs and introduce them to the younger generations.
Mm-hmm.
And something I hear some of the kids say, some of our listeners have reported that they're playing them for their kids, and they ask the kids, why is old-time radio better than TV? And the kids will say the pictures are better,
mm-hmm.
you know, because you used your mind.
That's
and,
right. That's right.
That's the magic of
that's
it all.
That's what it's all about.
Now, you said this is about 15 years ago that you really got into old-time radio. Why do you think it wasn't before? Was it just not a part of your life?
I deliberately pushed it aside.
Okay.
Because I was so... my life was so enveloped in movies.
Okay, yeah.
And very full. And I said, mm-hmm. you know, I don't have time for another hobby. I don't have time for another interest. And I was always aware of it, but I said, I think I have to just... kind of leave that to the side, and I did.
Because it was too big a thing to take on at that
yeah.
time, you think?
Yeah, I just, I was almost afraid to open that door and go
okay.
through it, because then I'd get hooked on something else, and I'm a collector. I've been collecting movie memorabilia since I was 12, and I said, oh, no, this will be the end of me. Because I have that kind of collector mentality, too, you know.
You must have a separate house just
like,
for all your stuff?
It's getting to that almost, and So that's another reason I put it off, was I didn't want to start another collection.
Right, yeah.
But now I have.
Okay, well, great. How did you go about doing all the research on this? I mean, did you do a lot of traveling to interview the people, or was it just by phone, or how do you make the contacts?
Some of everything. Well, I live in Los Angeles now. I'm from New York, but I now mm-hmm. live in Los Angeles.
Okay.
And so the first step was talking to people who were accessible and within easy reach.
Right.
I found out that Arch Obler lived like a mile from me, and
oh, wow.
And I got a contact to meet him and spend a wonderful afternoon with him. I think the first interview I did actually was through a friend who was then working as a writer on the TV show Remington Steele.
Okay.
And
uh-huh.
he said, you know, Elliot Lewis is
oh,
our
yes.
story editor. He says, and you've really got to talk to him. He's just got a million stories, and he's just great. And so he arranged for us all to have lunch, and then I sat and did a long interview with Elliot, which is maybe the best interview I got of all, because he did everything in radio, as you well know.
He was a triple threat man or better.
Actor, writer, producer, director,
yeah.
and great at all of those things. In fact, I asked a great many of the people I interviewed, who was the best radio actor you ever heard, or who was the best radio actor you ever worked with?
Right.
And an extraordinary number of them said, instantly, Elliot Lewis.
Yeah.
The irony, which I discuss in a chapter of the book, is that he thought nothing of acting.
Oh, okay.
He, who was so admired, sort of put down acting. perhaps because it came too easily to him, or so easily to him. He didn't think enough of it. He was much more involved in the writing and the directing and enjoyed that more.
But he was such a good actor. I mean, he could play like Frankie Remley on Phil Harris, play that smart alky character, but then he can go right over and play a dramatic role just as easily.
He could do Othello, which he did on Suspense, a two-part Suspense, where he did Othello in Shakespeare's language, but in modern conversational style.
Okay, yeah.
It was a very innovative show that he did, where he played Othello, and Richard Widmark played Iago, and his then-wife, Kathy Lewis, played Desdemona. Mm-hmm. And he wanted it to sound like conversation. That was his approach to it.
Okay.
So he didn't change any of the language, but he just, they spoke
modernized
it naturally.
Modernized it.
And it was just, it was all in their head. It was the approach that was modern.
Uh-huh.
And he was just the all-around Mr. Radio, and so it was a great thrill to talk to him. Then I was lucky. I made periodic trips to New York, and so I got to talk to some folks here in person. And then I ran up a large phone bill.
Right. Okay.
Talking to people all over the place, local, near, and far. And the other great lucky thing for me was that all these years I've been working for Entertainment Tonight, I get sent out on assignment and get to do a lot of interviews. And whenever I would interview somebody I thought, whether I was sure or not, had anything to do with radio, I would ask about it after I'd finished the official part of the interview.
Right.
And so I'd be sitting there with Gregory Peck, and I hadn't, you know, done my research, but I figured he must have done some Lux or Suspense,
which
of course he did.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, and we talked about that. And when I sat with Lauren Bacall, I knew she had done Bold Venture with Bogart, and they had done guest appearances on other shows. And some of those movie stars that I spoke to didn't have a lot to say, but sometimes they had something very specific to say that was very useful, and which I did use in the book. So that was a great blessing too. Was getting access to people that are not the easiest people to get hold of necessarily.
Right. Yeah. As far as old radio goes, do you have any favorites?
I think the Jack Benny Show, which is many people's favorite.
All right,
show,
you just earned points with me, Leonard.
Yeah, is also mine. It's the thing that really started me on old radio because my wife's favorite actor is Ronald Colman.
Okay.
And many years ago, a friend said, well, have you heard his appearances on the Jack Benny Show with his wife?
Mm-hmm.
And we said no, because as I say, we weren't into this.
Right.
And, he said, well, let me give you a couple of those to listen to. Well, that, you know, how could you not love those? And how could you not respond to those? And so that's what got us intrigued to hear more.
Mm-hmm. Well, they did the same thing with Mr. and Mrs. Jimmy Stewart.
Yes.
On the radio and later on,
and later
TV.
On the TV show. Yes.
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 The memorable one is the one. Where the IRS men come to visit Jack, and he's afraid like he's done something wrong, and it turns out that they think they haven't given him enough money back, and they're questioning his entertainment tax, like $3.85 or something like that. How could you do that? So they have to go over and interview Jimmy Stewart and his wife, and I don't know if his wife did a lot of acting.
No, though she started off, I think, to be an actress.
She had such great comic delivery.
Oh, yes.
I mean, that deadpan.
She's wonderful
type
in those.
Delivery.
I remember the one where they go out to the restaurant and Frank Nelson's the waiter to the TV episode, I mean.
Uh-huh.
That's one I always remember well. And Frank Nelson's another one I got to talk to. I mean, all these people who are no longer here, I feel so privileged to have spent some time
with. Mel Blanc?
Mel Blanc, absolutely.
Show too.
Mm-hmm. Phil Harris.
Uh-huh.
And so I have quite a roster of people that I got to talk to and that if I was starting this book today, I couldn't talk to.
Yeah. Well, it's very fortunate that you did, and I'm really looking forward to going through that. As far as conventions go, do you go to these very often?
I go to SpurdVac out in Los Angeles pretty regularly to that convention, but I haven't had the opportunity to come to this one in Newark before because I work for a daily TV show, so they keep me on a pretty short leash.
Yeah.
And if I'm not on assignment for them or on an actual vacation, I'm pretty much close to home.
Mm-hmm.
But with the book coming out this year, I felt it was really imperative that I get here.
Right. Well, we're very glad you did. And just jumping back a little bit, what do you think? Going back to where how you got started, what was your first, let's say, your first big publication that you got published in? Would you remember?
Yeah. Well, my first actual published piece was in a little magazine called the 8mm Collector.
Okay.
I was 13 years old. That magazine has evolved into something called Classic Images, which is still being published. It's
All right.
A tabloid-sized, newspaper-style, monthly for old movie buffs. It's a wonderful magazine, and still coming out of Davenport, Iowa.
Okay.
And the first big magazine I was publishing was Esquire when I was 18 years old.
Oh, that's...
And so that was a very exciting moment, as you can imagine,
yeah,
to be published there.
So when did it, you proceeded into TV? When did Entertainment Tonight, how long have you been with them?
I've been with them 15 years,
wow,
which is some sort of Guinness Book type record, I think, for somebody who never worked in television before, to land on a show... to stay at the same show 15 years, and for the show itself to stay on the air. The show is actually going into its 17th year, I think. I came toward the end of the first season.
Okay, yeah.
I joined them in May, the end of May of 82, and I'm still there.
What education? Did you, like... Have any degrees like in journalism?
Yeah, I majored in journalism at New York University.
Okay.
At the time, which is a long time ago, they did not have a major in film study.
Mm-hmm.
They had undergraduate, I mean.
Right.
You could major in filmmaking, which was really not what I wanted to pursue. So I majored in journalism because that's what interested me. I love to write, and
right.
I was fascinated with the whole arena of journalism. And I'm glad I did, because it was a great experience. They had a wonderful department there, and they had a great daily newspaper, and I worked on that daily paper for 4 years, and that was a terrific experience. So that was my background, and my first book, which was the very first edition of my paperback movie guide, which I still do every year. Now it's called Leonard Maltin's Movie and Video Guide. Then it was called TV Movies. The first edition of that, I signed the contract to do that when I was about to graduate from high school at age 17, and the book came out when I was 18 and in my first year of college. So that's quite something, and 28 years later, I'm still doing it.
That is one book my mom can't live without. She always has it right there as they're watching TV, and she thumbs through it, and that's the one, you know, they don't want for much. So when it comes Christmas time, it's hard to figure out what to get Mom and Dad, except get Mom the new Leonard Maltin book.
Oh, that's lovely. That's lovely.
So,
well, say hi to her for me.
I certainly will. Anything else you'd like to say about the book, or...
I don't think so.
Except
it's
buy
my
it?
It's, well, of course, I'd be delighted if somebody is interested enough to buy it. I hope they do. I'm very proud of it. It's been a labor of love. That I can certainly say. I mean, I can't say, you know, you have to tell me if you think it's good or not, but I can tell you that it was written with love. That much I can tell you.
Okay. There's also a little offer back here for a free CD.
Yes.
Which I believe comes from Carl Amari's
it
company,
does. Uh-huh.
Radio Spirits.
Three complete shows. A Jack Benny show with Ronald Coleman, Mr. and Mrs. Ronald Coleman.
Okay.
My favorite show of theirs from 46. My favorite episode of Escape of Three Skeleton Key.
Ah, yes.
And a Vic and Sade. What I wanted on the CD was not excerpts. I wanted three complete shows.
Mm, yes.
2 half-hour, 1 15-minute, which neatly fit unedited onto a CD.
Mm-hmm.
And because I wanted for people, you know, I'm hoping, I don't know if this is realistic or not, but I'm hoping people who are not already hooked on radio might pick up this book.
Right.
And might be interested enough that they want to get involved.
Mm-hmm.
And so the CD is a way of getting their feet wet.
Well,
that's the idea of
that's it. That's nice. Well, Leonard, I'd like to thank you for your time and being here with us here on The Glowing Dial and sharing all this information with us, telling us about your new book and everything. Good luck with the sales of the new book and all that, and we'll see you at the movies.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Hi, this is Leonard Maltin, and you're listening to The Glowing Dial with Big John and Steve here on Yesterday USA.
All right, we are back. Thank you, Leonard Maltin, for that wonderful interview. We are going to get back into old-time radio now with a show by request. This is going out to Doris and Gerald Covey, who wrote in. We played them a Hearthstone of the Death Squad last time, and we're going to play another request since I got it in. I believe they were also asking for Count of Monte Cristo. A little history on that show. It was an adventure drama based on the novel by Alexandre Dumas. I was always going to say Dupre there. Alexandre Dumas. It was on the Don Lee Network, West Coast only, 1944 to 45, and then it went to Mutual, and at various different times there. Featured Carlton Young as Edmond Dantes, the enigmatic and swashbuckling Count of Monte Cristo, and Stone as the Count's friend and conspirator, the lovely Marie Duchesne, and numerous other people. The announcer was Rod O'Connor, a very familiar name, wonderful announcer. And that information coming from John Dunning's new book, On the Air, The Encyclopedia of Old Time Radio. Sorry as I leaned away from the microphone to put the book down. I'm going to reach over to my friend here, the McGee Machine, and we're going to tune this one in. I'm sorry I don't have an air date for this, but it's Count of Monte Cristo, Log of the Black Widow. Ooh, and we hope you enjoy. So as my friend the McGee Machine, there he is, that's that familiar sound. As he starts warming up, we're going to get ready to play you this episode. And so sit back, close your eyes, and remember, the Count of Monte Cristo, the Log of the Black Widow, tonight's episode, and we'll be back to say goodbye.
Edmond Dantes, the fabulous Count of Monte Cristo. It is late at night in the Parisian home of the Count of Monte Cristo. The Count is reading under a shaded lamp whose cheerful glow forms a contrast to the rainstorm beating against the casement windows. Nodding in the well-upholstered chair is René Michon, his good friend and faithful secretary. The striking of an antique clock arouses René.
Dear me, monsieur. Oh, midnight. The witching hour. And I might add, an excellent night for ghouls and evil spirits to sally forth.
Perhaps, René, it would be advisable to close the north window. The rain is slanting against it, and we wish neither ghouls nor rainwater to disturb us.
Certainly, monsieur. but I am growing sleepy.
Well, may I suggest a journey to your bedchamber?
Sensible suggestion, monsieur. But I must confess that curiosity conquers drowsiness.
Curiosity?
Yes, about the expected visit of the Baron François Montigny.
The message from his courier was rather mysterious.
Asking you to spare him the time for an interview in this weather and so late at night.
Yes, he should have been here at least an hour ago. Or perhaps the storm...
Pardon, it should end if I disturb it, but a young lady is asking for you.
A young lady? At this hour?
What is her name, Bertuccio?
Signorina Jeannette Fortier.
Jeannette Fortier? Do not recall her.
Well, I have seen beautiful ladies pursue you before, monsieur, but never in a storm like this.
She said you would know her brother, Henri, and Signor Conde, if you will permit me to remark it. She is so beautiful and in such a, how you say, a distress, that it is difficult to receive.
Henri Fortier. Wait, I do remember him. Bertuccio, I'll see the young lady.
Thank you, Excellency. I bring her to you immediately.
Monsieur, just who is this Henri Fortier?
A young man of great promise, René. He first came to my attention when he was an ordinary seaman before the mast of one of my clipper ships. He was so courteous and willing to learn that I taught him the rudiments of navigation. I believe that he later qualified as a ship's officer.
But whatever can his sister want?
Well, perhaps Henri's in some trouble.
And the Baron Montigny? He's due to arrive at any moment, sir.
As the owner of a merchant fleet of swift clippers, the Baron is a very important man, René. Nevertheless, the welfare of Henri Fortier is important to me.
La Signorina Jeannette Fortier.
Monsieur Lacroix, a thousand pardons for this intrusion, but you are the only one to whom I can turn.
Mademoiselle, I hope that I can be of service. May I present my trusted friend and companion, Monsieur Michon?
Monsieur.
A pleasure, mademoiselle. Allow me to take your cloak. You will find this chair particularly comfortable.
Thank you. Has your servant told you that I am the sister of Henri Fortier?
He has, mademoiselle. Is your brother in some difficulty?
He is stricken with a fever, monsieur, and is delirious.
Has he had medical attention?
Oh, yes. Everything possible is being done for him.
Well, how can I be of assistance?
I'm not sure.
Not sure, mademoiselle?
I must echo René's astonishment. I should like to help, but I shall have to know how. If money is required, you need feel no embarrassment.
Oh, you are kind. So very kind, monsieur. Just as Henri described you. I beg that you will not call my worries mere wanderings of an hysterical mind.
Of course not, mademoiselle. What has happened?
My brother Henri recently returned from a voyage to America. He was aboard a clipper ship.
As an officer?
Thanks to your interest, monsieur, he sailed as third mate. Fever broke out on the ship. Henri fell victim to it.
I'm sorry, mademoiselle.
He seemed to recover, but then suffered a relapse and was forced to bed again. Over a period of days, his mind has been affected.
Well, in what way, mademoiselle? Well,
any number of times he has dressed himself and attempted to go to his new ship, despite my explanations that she's already sailed. His poor delirious brain cannot grasp the truth.
When he has recovered, I shall see that he has a second mate's berth on one of my ships. Will that assist you in solving your troubles?
You are most generous of you. Your offer will be of great value to Henri's future. I fear, however, that it will not solve the present danger.
Indeed, mademoiselle?
It is... Oh, please do not laugh. The faces at the window.
Faces at the window?
Tell me exactly what you have seen, Mademoiselle Fortier.
I have not seen these faces. Henri claims to have seen them peering through the window into his sick room.
Probably just the effects of the delirium.
That is what I thought, until tonight. I was preparing some hot broth for Henri when I heard him cry out. Rushing into his room, I saw that the window was open and swinging in the gale. My brother was muttering about the faces. Faces of men who wished to capture him.
The wind could have blown the window open.
That occurred to me, but I investigated. Monsieur le Comte, I saw marks of a knife on the casement. The latch on the window had been forced open.
Mademoiselle, did you inform the gendarmes?
I've been to them twice, telling them about my brother's fears. They merely insisted that he was delirious. So tonight, rather than see them, I found a carriage for hire and came to you.
I hope you did not leave your brother alone.
Oh, no, monsieur. There's old Pierre Boisseau, a distant relative who lives in the village of Saint-Germain. He's been staying at the cottage to help me care for Henri.
This Pierre Boisseau is old, you say?
Oh, yes, and feeble. I took all possible precautions, however. The door has a strong bolt, and we piled furniture in front of Henri's window. When I left, old Pierre was doing his best to nail boards across the other casement.
Then there's no time to lose. René.
Yes, monsieur?
Please follow my instructions carefully. Have the second coachman...
Excellency.
Yes, what is it, Bertuccio?
The Baron Montaigne calls upon you.
Very good. Show him in, please.
Medium end, Excellency.
Now, René.
Yes, monsieur. Have the second coachman...
Take you and Mademoiselle Fortier to her cottage at once. Have two of our strongest, most dependable servants accompany you. Guard Henri Fortier until I arrive.
Yes, monsieur. And when will you arrive?
I shall have Battistan drive me there the moment I have concluded my conference with Baron Montigny. Mademoiselle, what is your address?
It is on the Rue de Vanvey, number 18 in Saint-Cloud. Oh, monsieur, I cannot thank you.
Do not take time to thank me, mademoiselle. That side door leads to the courtyard.
This way, mademoiselle. I have your cloak.
Thank you, monsieur. You are both so very kind.
Signor Il Conde. The Baron Francois Montigny.
It is good of you to see me at this late hour, my dear Monte Cristo. I'm here at the command of His Majesty King Louis Philippe.
I assumed that your visit was one of importance. What does the King desire of me?
Some information. But first, I must tell you what has taken place. Recently, I purchased a new clipper ship, the Black Widow.
Rather a sinister name.
If it was painted a dead Black Widow seemed appropriate. I had no idea that she would claim the life of a man on her first voyage. But more of that in a moment. I added her to my merchant fleet and sent her on her maiden voyage to Boston and then back to Cherbourg. On this trip, she established a record for the fastest day sailing in history. In 24 hours, she covered 359 miles.
Remarkable.
That you say, most remarkable. This performance was undoubtedly due to certain radical departures in her design.
Small wonder His Majesty is interested.
Ah, you have guessed the nature of tonight's conference. As you know, the clipper ships have followed the pattern of our fast French men of war. Any improvement is of extreme importance to the Navy.
Temporarily, at least.
I do not follow you, my dear Count.
We cannot ignore the steamboat. It is already proving itself.
True, yet we cannot be too radical. There is the question of fuel, and some of the steamboats have exploded. But this is beside the point. Now, this record-breaking sail must be kept a secret. Foreign powers must not know of it.
But what are the ship's officers who kept the log? They would be the first to boast of such an achievement the moment they arrived in port.
Fortunately, Captain Letar of the Black Widow realized the significance of the record. He kept it a secret from the crew and instructed the ship's officers to remain silent. Letar is a man of utmost integrity.
Can the officers be trusted?
The first mate, Delfos, has sailed on my ship for many years. I can vouch for him. Belanger, the second mate, fell victim to a fever that broke out aboard ship. While delirious, he wandered away from his cabin and evidently fell overboard. You will recall my remark about the Black Widow claiming the life of a man. Most tragic occurrence.
I assume that the only other person who could have seen a ship's logbook containing a description of the record was the third mate.
Yes. His name is Fortier.
Fortier. Do you refer to Henri Fortier?
I do. We discovered he once served you. That is why the King wished me to see you immediately. His Majesty is concerned about the secrecy of this information and desires your opinion of Fortier's character.
I have every reason to believe that Henri can be trusted. There is, however, a danger.
A danger? You do not have complete confidence in him?
My fears do not concern his character. Tonight, his sister came to me with word that Fortier still suffers from the fever that took the life of your second mate. He's had a relapse and is delirious.
Ah, I follow your thinking. A fever-ridden tongue might unwittingly reveal the secret. He must be carefully guarded.
I have just sent my secretary and two servants to the Fortier cottage.
Then Henri has said something. And you knew the situation even before my visit.
No, Monsieur Le Baron. I sent Rennie for another reason. There is strong evidence that an attempt is being made to abduct Henri Fortier. Men have tried to break into the cottage.
Ah. Then there's a flaw in our carefully laid plans. Somehow a rumor has reached Fallen Aiken.
So it would appear. If Henri were held prisoner while delirious, there's every possibility that information could be obtained from him.
But who could have let the secret escape?
Are you sure that Belanger, the second mate, is actually dead?
No one saw him fall overboard. There is the fantastic possibility that he is still alive.
Who else knows about the Black Widow's record-breaking besides the persons you've named?
There's Admiral Gerard Dulac.
And where is the logbook that describes the passage?
At the Admiral's offices. But he would be sure to guard it with the utmost caution. Of course, one of his subordinates might have seen it. This is a terrible situation. We must take steps immediately.
I told Rennie that I would go to the Fortier cottage as soon as you and I had finished our conference.
Then let us go without delay. The future of the French Navy is threatened.
And so is the life of a loyal citizen, Henri Fortier. That is Sam.
Yes, Your Excellency.
We're coming to the house. Draw up as close to the door as you can.
Yes, Monsieur Le Comte.
Very thoughtful of you, Monte Cristo. I do not relish the thought of walking far in this mud.
Rennie is waiting at the door for us with a lantern.
Perhaps it is just the play of the light across his face, but I would say that he looks troubled.
We will soon know.
I'm so glad you have arrived. Something terrible has happened.
What is it, Rennie?
We were too late. Henri Fortier is gone.
Gone? Do you mean he's been captured?
According to the old man, Pierre Boisseau, he was taken prisoner by two men and carried off in a carriage shortly before we arrived.
René, the situation has a deeper significance than we first suspected. This is Baron Montigny, who has reason to believe that the abduction of Henri is the work of foreign agents.
Oh, monsieur, what does it mean?
There's no time for explanations, René. Where is Pierre Boisseau?
Well, the poor old fellow is in the kitchen. You'd best talk to him yourself. He's so upset, it's almost impossible to understand his story.
And Jeanette Fortier?
She is in her room, monsieur. I prevailed upon her to rest for a few moments. The servants are guarding the cottage. The kitchen is in here.
Please do not punish me. It was not my fault. I swear it was not my fault.
There, Monsieur Boisseau, calm yourself. We know you did no wrong.
I was trying to protect Henri. That is how it happened.
Yes, yes. Just tell us what took place. Slowly and carefully.
Yes. And who might you be, monsieur?
I am the Baron Montigny. This is the Count of Monte Cristo.
And on your honor as nobleman, you will not cause me any harm.
If your story is an honest one, you have nothing to fear.
Oh, it is honest enough. You see, gentlemen, after Jeanette left tonight, Henri was again seized with the idea that he must join his ship. He began to dress, shirt, trousers, and shoes. In vain, I tried to stop him. And then his sudden energy expended, and he fell back on the bed as though in a trance. And I removed his shoes and covered him with blankets.
You did not attempt to undress him?
Please, Monsieur Le Baron, do not say that I did wrong. I did only what I had to do. I had to finish nailing boards across the windows on the inside. It was my promise to Jeanette.
Yes, of course. I understand.
I managed to secure all the windows except one. The window in the room next to Henri's bedchamber.
Well, why did you neglect that?
I did not neglect it. I had no more nails. The boards were sufficient, but there were no nails. Who can nail without nails? Now answer me that, good gentleman.
An impossible task.
Why, of course it is impossible. So I went to find nails. I came back into the kitchen. I looked in the cupboard. No nails. I looked on the shelf. No nails. I looked everywhere.
And there were no nails.
No.
I think we understand, Monsieur Boisseau. Now, please tell us what happened.
But I searched for a long time, and then I thought I heard a noise. I ran to Henri's room, and he was gone. I ran to the unbarred window, and it was open. Outside, I saw two men, and they were forcing Henri into a carriage.
Could you see their faces?
Yes, monsieur, I could, in the light of the carriage lamp.
Did they see you?
But I do not know. They may have. There was a light in the room.
Well, how long ago did this happen?
It is hard to say. Not too long ago.
Then there's a chance that we can follow that carriage.
But how, monsieur? They will be far ahead of us by now.
Few vehicles travel in this district and at this hour. The mud caused by the rainstorm should reveal the wheel tracks left by the criminals. Rene, I must ask you to remain here with our servants to care for Mademoiselle Jeannette. The Baron and I will go with Battistan in my coach.
And I also shall accompany you.
But you're very tired, monsieur, and you've had a trying experience.
Yes, but I have my duty. I allowed him to be captured, and now I shall help to save him. I insist.
Very well, then. Let us go at once.
Now, my gentlemen, watch closely at this point. Three roads meet here. We might lose the wheel tracks.
Battistar, the track's still clear.
It is sometimes difficult to see with only the coach lights, Your Excellency, but we have not lost them.
Ah, good.
Be careful of this fork in the road. Might be confusing.
There is no trouble, monsieur. The tracks follow the left-hand fork.
Excellent.
The left-hand road. That is the route I take to and from my home in the village of Saint-Germain. Find it rather deserted.
You seem to know this district well, Monsieur Boisseau.
Oh, well, I should know it well. I walk it every day.
You walk from the village of Saint-Germain to Saint-Cloud?
Oh, no. I merely walk to the high road. Just enough exercise for a man of my age. And then some passing cart is certain to give me a ride the rest of the way.
Slow there. Your Excellency, I believe that the carriage stopped at this point. I thought you might wish to investigate.
I do indeed, Battistan. Baron, give me the carriage lantern, if you please.
Yes.
Thank you. Now, let us see. Ah, yes. The carriage pulled to the side of the road. See? Now, see what happened. The vehicle seems to have stood here for some time. Notice the horses stamped in the mud.
Look. Look. Here are footprints.
But why did the men leave the carriage?
Wait, here is a footprint that tells the story. A man, barefoot.
Henri. I had removed his shoes. That is Henri's footprint.
Seems to have jumped from the carriage and began to run.
And his captors followed this way.
Yes.
See?
Yes.
The tracks follow the road and then turn off.
Onto the grass and are lost. Then the abductor's tracks return to where our carriage was waiting.
Henri, escape them. He may be hiding there in the forest.
If his fever-stricken body has survived the ordeal. Come along, let's go further through this underbrush.
Oh.
Wait.
What was that?
I heard nothing.
It comes from behind that bush. Hurry.
It is, Harry. He is alive.
He has wandered in a circle and come back to his starting point.
My watch. I must stand my watch.
He's still delirious. Lift him carefully and we'll carry him to the car.
Yes. Take me to the bridge. I must get the charts.
That's it. Betty Stamp, spread the coach blankets on the rear seat.
Immediately, monsieur.
Where are the charts? I cannot see the compass. There's a fog. A fog is rolling in.
Poor fellow. The fog is rolling in over his tortured mind.
Boisseau, hold the coach door open, please. Easy. Place him on the blankets and cover him well. That's it. Better stand, we're ready. Back to the Fortier cottage at once.
Immediately, Your Excellency.
Fortier must have the best of care. I shall make arrangements in my household to have him and his sister remain under my roof until all is well. And, my dear Count, I would appreciate it if your servants would guard the cottage until I can put my plan into effect. It will be only a matter of hours.
The cottage will be well protected.
I shall never be at ease until the criminals are arrested.
Every effort will be made to do so.
Then you have a plan?
Before noon today, I intend to visit the offices of Admiral Dulac. I am doubly concerned, Admiral Dulac. A naval secret is in peril, and so is the safety of a fine young ship's officer.
Yes, of course. I understand your position exactly.
Do any of your subordinates know of this matter?
Only very few, and I believe that they are absolutely trustworthy.
Who has seen the logbook of the Black Widow?
Well, The ship's officers, His Majesty, Baron Montigny, and myself, no one else. I'm not surprised at the foreign agent's attempted abduction. Their chief interest is undoubtedly to locate the logbook. Much information about the performance of the Black Widow is contained in its pages.
The book is in a safe place?
Extremely so. If Monsieur Michon will move his chair, I will show you.
René? René?
Yes, what is it?
Admiral Dulac wishes to move your chair.
Oh, yes, of course. Of course.
Poor René had no sleep last night at the 48 cottage.
I quite understand. Now, I pull this drapery aside, and you see the door of my confidential strongbox. There is only one key which is continually on my person. There it is. The history-making log of the Black Widow.
The Admiral is very kind.
These pages, which you now have opened, describe the way in which the fever broke out on the return voyage. If it had not been for the sickness and the storms that were encountered, it would seem logical that the Black Widow could actually have captured the record for the fastest transatlantic crossing.
Yes. It's extremely interesting.
Yeah. You are reading about one of the worst storms they encountered. You'll notice how pleased the officers were with the way the Black Widow handled in bad weather.
Yes. Yes, so I see. But, Admiral, we must not take any more of your time. Come along, René. We must be off.
Yes, monsieur.
Admiral, you've been of great assistance.
Indeed. Well, hope you find time for some sleep, at least. Good day, gentlemen.
Goodbye, and thank you, monsieur.
Hey, good day, Admiral Dulac. Oh, what a shame, monsieur, that you did not learn more from Admiral Dulac.
To the contrary, René. I learned a great deal. Not from the Admiral, but from the log of the Black Widow.
But you merely glanced through its pages.
I saw enough to influence my future actions. Baristan, we're going to visit Henri and his sister at the Baron Montigny's home. They should be there by now.
Yes, monsieur.
Monsieur, what did you see in the logbook?
Something that told me I have been wrong.
Wrong, monsieur?
I have assumed, as we all have, that foreign agents have been trying to abduct our young ship's officer.
Well, the evidence most certainly points that way.
No longer, René. I'm now convinced that someone is trying to murder Henri Fortier. Mademoiselle, has your brother's condition grown worse?
No, Monsieur Le Comte, it is not that. Poor old Pierre Boisseau.
He has been seriously wounded by a bullet, obviously fired by one of the foreign agents he saw last night.
Then they must have seen him when he went to the window.
Yes. Where did this occur?
On the road. The left-hand road beyond the fork where he walks to the high road when he leaves our cottage.
Fortunately, the criminal's aim was bad. Old Pierre staggered to the high road where the gendarme took him to a hospital.
He insisted on walking the road as usual early this morning. He was anxious to reach home. Oh, it is so terrible.
Come, come, my dear. You must dry your eyes. Ah, here comes Dr. Vachon with permission, I am sure, for you to visit with your brother for a little while.
But not too long, if you please. The patient is still very weak.
Would you care to see him, Monsieur Le Comte?
I shall send René in my place. There's a question I should like to ask Dr. Vachon.
Then come with me, Monsieur Michel.
At your service, mademoiselle.
You must not let Henri know about this.
Dr. Vachon, I see you have your medical kit with you.
Like all doctors, I carry this bag with me. Why do you ask?
My coachman has crushed his finger. He waits outside with only a handkerchief for a bandage. Perhaps you'd be good enough to go to his assistance.
Why, I have no such medicines in my kit.
No unguents of any kind?
None whatever.
Is not that rather strange?
I do not think so.
But you will at least apply a proper bandage.
I have an important call to make. I have no time.
I demand that you treat my coachman.
Now, look here, Monte Cristo. This is my home. I have employed Vachon. You have no right to address the doctor in that manner.
I do not address a doctor. Vachon is one of your henchmen, hired by you to bring about the death of Henri Fortier.
My dear Count, you must have caught Henri's fever. You are delirious.
Is it delirium when I say that the log of the Black Widow is false? Am I fevered when I declare that you bribed the captain and the first mate to claim a record so that the shipbuilding firm who built the Clipper would get a naval contract?
Ridiculous. Why should I do such a thing?
Because you have a secret financial interest in the shipbuilding company. You could hire men to serve you in your criminal plans, Montigny, but you knew that Henri Fortier could not be bribed. That's why you sent your assassins to kill him. Why, when they failed, you employed this fraudulent doctor to hasten Henri's death from fever?
Monte Cristo, you have placed yourself in a dangerous position. This rapier that hangs within a few inches of my hand upon the wall might easily run you through despite your boasted swordsmanship.
I accept the challenge on guard.
Vachon, bring the horses to the side entrance.
At once, Mr. the Baron.
When I have killed you, Monte Cristo, I plan to take an extended trip.
I fear that trip will be postponed.
Yes, you are very confident.
Under other circumstances, I would enjoy this sword, say. You're a very clever duelist, Monsieur le Baron. But I'm afraid I must conclude it thus.
My shoulder. Merci, monsieur.
I had no intention of murdering you as you tried to kill Fortier and poor old Boisseau. I shall give you to the gendarmes as a living example of greed and villainy.
Well, it's been some time since you were in the village of Saint-Germain, monsieur.
Pierre will be overjoyed to see us. Happy is the day they allowed him to leave the hospital.
I'm anxious to see Boisard's garden.
Henri can remember every little path and sundial.
Yes, I used to play there as a child. When I was small, it seemed to be a great estate. Now it appears to be only the size of a pocket handkerchief. Do you enjoy gardens, Monsieur Le Comte?
More than the average person, Henri.
Is it not wonderful to be driving in the sunshine and speaking of gardens? When less than a month ago, we were under a cloud of tragedy.
We must forget that cloud, my dear.
You are right, monsieur. But may I ask just one question about how you unmasked Montini's villainy?
And if he asks a question, monsieur, I beg the same privilege.
Very well, then. Henri, what do you wish to know?
Well, how were you first certain that Montini was a scoundrel?
Well, in addition to ourselves, he was the only one who knew the path regularly taken by Boisseau on his way to Saint-Germain from Saint-Cloud. Mancini obviously instructed his henchmen to shoot the old man from that particular ambush.
Now, monsieur, is it my turn?
Yes, René.
What did you see in the log of the Black Widow that told you it was false?
The handwriting looked genuine enough and was probably that of the captain and the first mate. At one point, however, the logbook described a storm, a very bad storm, in writing so smooth that it might well have been penned while floating on a mill pond. There. Those are your answers.
Oh, but I, too, am going to claim one. Your chivalry cannot deny a lady.
Of course not, Jeanette. I must comply.
How did you know that Montigny was a secret partner in the shipbuilding firm?
You promised to keep the answer a secret?
Oh, I promise.
That, my dear, was a very fortunate guess.
Ladies and gentlemen, the star of our program, Carlton Young.
Thank you, Dick. Next week, friends, on the anniversary of the fall of the Bastille, we bring you a timely story that introduces a character that I'm sure you will find interesting. Until then, good night.
The Count of Monte Cristo is produced and directed by Jaime Del Valle and stars Carlton Young in the title role, with Parley Bear appearing as René Michon. Others in our cast this evening were Jack Petruzzi, Virginia Gregg, Jay Novello, Ed Colemans, Howard McNear, and John Daner. This adaptation of the character made famous by Alexander Dumas was written by Jay Fryer, with music by Dean Foster. This is Dick Wynn, inviting you to join us next week at this time for another adventure taken from the exciting life of The Count of Monte Cristo. This is the Mutual Don Lee Broadcasting System.
Hi, this is Bob Hastings. Just telling you that you should be listening to Glowing Dial with Big John and Steve on Yesterday USA. Don't miss it. It's fun.
Thank you, Bob. And yes, so was the interview with Bob we had on, I think, last time. Folks, that's going to do it for us. Just enough time to say please write to us. The Glowing Dial, 1401 Key West, Troy, Michigan, 48083-1055. Phone number to reach us at is 810 774-0112. And the email address is glodial, G-L-O-D-I-A-L, at ix.netcom.com. And as I said, that's just going to do it for us this time around. Thank you for joining us on behalf of an absent Steve Urbanek. This is Big John saying keep a positive thought, keep looking up, and we'll see you on radio. Bye-bye.
Yesterday, USA, Superstation.